Hi, this is Jem, and you're listening to KJEM Radio with Craig and Amy.
This is KJEM, KJEM Radio, and we are on the air. I'm Craig Phillips.
And I'm Amy Rhodes. We are your hosts, and we want to welcome you to our sixth episode of the Truly Outrageous World of JEM right here on KJEM Radio.
This week, we're talking about the fourth episode called Frame Up from the JEM miniseries.
Don't forget that you can always participate in our show if you would like by calling in at 1-724-444-7444 with the call-in ID is 93860.
So what we're going to do with Frame Up is we're going to go a little bit back and back a little bit. We had a very special guest last week.
That's right.
That was amazing,
that was awesome.
Too. Yeah, it really was, and I have to say that was just absolutely brilliant that she stopped by and talked to us, so we want to thank her once again.
Overtime, thank you so much, Desiree. A big thank you from both of us.
So that's why we're actually on the fourth episode, although technically it's our sixth episode. We skipped over last week's episode for Desiree's interview. So basically, going back a little bit to Kimber's Rebellion, what we basically find is that JEM and the Holograms all take a trip out to Paris to film their video with the Countess de Vaussan, and they also film with Anthony Julian. The Misfits, of course, create havoc by going out there, yada, yada, yada. Then they come back to the States and get a phone call from Lindsay Pierce asking if they want to be on her show. I take that back. She only asked JEM if she can be on the show. Of course, then that's when Kimber throws her fit, storms out, whatever. They call her back. Things like that happen. And, you know, so that's kind of the Kimber's Rebellion kind of thing. So for the for Frame Up, you have Lindsay do an interview with the girls, and of course, Misfits decide they have to crash the party. And they have Ashley, who is not really a misfit, but she's kind of adopted as a misfit, I guess you could say. And she is essentially, you know, trying to distract the security guard that's blocking the door. They all go in. They have this, you know, they basically interrupt the entire show. And as Pizzazz was, and the misfits are being kicked out, she backhands Lindsay across the face, which I still can't believe that was gotten away with. And then, to make matters worse, she then elbows Rio right into the stomach, and then he goes flying backwards into a bunch of equipment, which essentially, you know, as the term goes, literally they brought down the house. So that's kind of where it picks up at, is this whole big explosion of equipment falling all over around JEM.
The first of this episode picks up with JEM being in great danger. There's power, electricity going everywhere, wires, equipment falling, giant speakers. Rio, of course, swoops in to save the day. He saves her at the last second. They ask, you know, if everybody's okay. They see that nobody's badly hurt, but JEM is really shaken up by this, and they send her to Lindsay's dressing room to go rest. And so the Holograms end up finishing out the interview. Aja wants to make it short so they can check on JEM. So, again, Rio is the hero in this, and again, he ends up kissing JEM.
I find that very disturbing, too.
Yeah, that was in the dressing room, and then they get interrupted. The Holograms come in when they're kissing, and Rio is so embarrassed. He is caught red-handed, and he, like, makes some excuse to get out of there as quick as possible.
I think it wasn't Aja that opens up the door.
Yeah,
wasn't Aja the one opening up the door, and she's like, oops, sorry.
Yeah, and then JEM's explanation of, oh, Rio's very proud, and I'm like, I'm going, that's no excuse, but okay.
You're kind of cheating. I mean, regardless if you're the same person, it's borderline cheating, you know,
and
at least in my book it is.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he doesn't know they're the same person. He shouldn't be embarrassed.
That's really true.
And that's more proof, that scene to me is more proof that, you know, Jerrica, JEM should have told him right from the start, you know, that she was JEM. Because when JEM was created, she had that opportunity, that opportunity of just a little time where it would have been really appropriate to tell him. Of course, we all know why she didn't. You know, the show has to have this triangle, love triangle going on. But, yeah, again, she missed that opportunity, and she's going to keep feeling more and more bad about him not knowing. So,
Yeah, it's so weird too because she's always been the epitome of not deceiving and not lying to people, and yet the one guy that she's loved more, as the years have gone on, because she grew up with him and she fell in love with him back in like junior high or high school, and here she is, the guy that she loves, and she's totally deceiving him,
Yeah,
which we'll
well,
talk about
here's
later
her
because she makes
part.
a video for that.
Yeah, we'll get on to that later. But in the next little mini scene, it just shows a real quick clip of Mrs. Bailey noticing, Ashley's behavior lately. So Jerrica goes to talk to her and doesn't get anywhere because she just gets interrupted. And then Ashley runs off again, straight to the Misfits. But then it goes back. The next part is about. We introduce Mr. Hayes, the promoter for Vegas, wanting the Misfits and the Holograms to be in the same show together. And he knows all too well that they don't get along, and that's why he wants them all to perform together because I love to see sparks fly, is what he said. He's so proud of that. They make him into
Yeah,
like
I
a
thought that
pig or
was funny.
something.
It,
Yeah.
I really thought that was funny because it's like, he knows that these are the two of the biggest bands in the world, pitting the Misfits and JEM and the Holograms. But I think the one thing that I don't think the Misfits quite caught on to, especially when they signed the contract with him, is they're the opening act and JEM and the Holograms are the headliners. Now, if you guys know how state or how concerts are run, the headlining act gets like an hour and a half to 2 hours of a show, whereas
Right.
the opening band gets 30 minutes to 45 minutes. I mean, that's like kind of like the ultimate slap in the face to two of these super groups. Because essentially, the Misfits were around a little bit longer than JEM and the Holograms, as we know from the very first episode. And, they were already playing concerts, and they already
Yeah,
had
I wonder if
the
they even read the contract. I wonder if they knew when they signed that they were going to open for the holograms, because it doesn't sound like they'd be too thrilled about that.
Well, we would know that Roxy wouldn't read it because she don't know how to
Well, of
read.
course not. And Pizzazz probably is like, oh, whatever, we're the big stars, But then they do
Yeah,
everything
and
they
she's looking at a
can
free
to.
concert anyway, so. Or I should say a concert to make money, not a free concert. This is actually an actual money
No.
maker.
She wants to make money, but she also wants more than anything to be famous. So it's just hard to believe that she would settle for an opening act. But, of course they don't. They do everything they can to become the main act.
Oh, that's
Anyway,
very true.
on to the next part. Oh, what I thought was funny though about that scene is when they do find out that JEM and the Holograms are performing at the same time, Roxy is ready to kill that guy, Mr. Hayes. She just like goes after him. I thought that was funny.
That's what I love about Roxy. Then she is a no nonsense girl. I mean, it's funny that for as many times as the Misfits have been, messed over by Eric. It's very rare that the girls will ever go after him, especially Roxy. I mean, that she's got a temper and she's, probably got a little bit of Italian running through them veins,
I think so.
and just you would think that she's just gonna go storming off after them, or after that guy. So, go figure that
Yeah.
she never did in later episodes. But
And then Pizzazz, I think it's funny that she, she's like, shut up. I've got the brains here. It's like, okay. Do you
Yeah, I
really?
love that
All
part.
right. Go ahead.
Yeah,
Come
no,
up with some half-baked scheme.
Well, isn't that just typical of the Misfits? They'll just come up with any kind of half-baked scheme. I mean, they don't
Oh,
even think
yeah.
anything through. They're just impulsive.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm kind of surprised sometimes Roxy being as tough as she is that she lets Pizzazz talk to her that way. It's like nobody else can get away with it but Pizzazz.
I think she's
Anyway.
actually scared of Pizzazz a little bit like Stormer is,
I don't know. I don't sense that. I don't sense that from Roxy. I don't think she's scared of her.
Yeah.
Everybody's got their own view on it. I know Stormer is scared of Pizzazz and Roxy with
Yeah,
good
which we
reason.
find out later. That's
Yeah.
true. With going to Ashley, one of the things that I noticed with Ashley is that she's starting to kind of wise up that maybe this isn't such a good idea to hang out with the Misfits, and you kind of see
Yeah,
that
just a
later
little
on.
bit. Just starting to see it at that point. And they ask her to, see, at this point, they ask her to go with them to Vegas, and she's all excited. She thinks she's being included. She thinks they really like her and they want her around, which is not the case. So I feel kind of bad for her. And
Yeah, I
then,
do too. I think she is really manipulated a little too much in that. And
yeah.
she's 13 years old, which she makes herself very known on that one. You know, the one thing I've figured with this one is that you start to see that, you know what, she doesn't really want to do these things, you know, but she has.
She kind of just, it's like she wants to be included, so she just kind of falls in with them, is the impression that I got. Anyway, we switch over to suddenly they're arriving in Vegas, and of course, Jem is still upset about Rio. She doesn't know what to do. She hates deceiving him, but she just doesn't know, should she tell him? Should she not tell him? What's his reaction going to be? And then we have the song Deception, which is quite fitting in that spot. I really like the video for Deception. I like the imagery in it, especially the part where you see Jerrica and Jem literally pulling Rio apart, just tug of war. I think that's very, very appropriate, very symbolic, you know.
Yeah,
One
it
of my
really
favorite
is.
parts of that video.
Yeah, I agree 100% with that. I think that, you know, with very early on with those videos, in fact, that Rio was in a lot of them. I mean, he was
Oh, yeah.
part of those videos, you know, and I always found that really interesting that when you see him in the videos, you almost always see some kind of tug of war that she's going, you know, that she's going through with him, and they kind of physically, you know, show it in the videos, which I like,
Yeah,
what I said is really good.
it really symbolizes her inner tug of war with her two sides to herself. And so I thought that was really
Absolutely.
cute.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, we're
Now,
gonna go to the phone lines real quick here and take our first caller for the night. Go ahead, Princess Hikaru.
so I was having trouble getting in. My phone was being stupid. But like going back to Roxy and like how she's afraid of pizzazz, I don't think she's afraid of pizzazz. She's just smart. I mean, she's got that mansion and all that food that she can just crash at, and I would not mess with pizzazz if I had all that.
Oh, you know what? I like that. That is really good because Roxy and Stormer are all about the money, and pizzazz is more about the look at me, the fame, you know? Good point.
Yeah, Roxy's more about the food than anything else.
I know. That's right.
But no, I agree, and I think you make a really valid point there that, you know, Roxy, you know, maybe I am wrong, maybe Roxy is not, but you know, with her temperament the way she is, you would think she would not put up with Pizzazz's mouth the way she does.
Oh,
I
I
mean,
know.
how she pushes, like, Pizzazz literally like just pushes Roxy away after she puts down the sign. She's like, you know, shut up, I've got the brains here. It's like, I don't get how Roxy did not just freak out at her. Now, maybe, obviously, you know, you got to move the show along, whatever, but I just don't think in reality you would ever push Roxy around. Just not in my
You
opinion.
know, yeah, I mean, we all have our different views on it, but yeah, Hikaru has a point about, you know, Roxy doesn't want to lose the food and the mansion. I mean, I think, and a lot of times I think they stay at Pizzazz's mansion. I mean, I know like Stormer has her own house and stuff, but I really think that they hang out there most of the time with Pizzazz at the big mansion so they can eat all the food and party and do whatever they want. So they like that good life, that rock star life. So Roxy wouldn't want to jeopardize that.
No, that's very true here. You know, and then of course, one of the things that I always thought was really interesting is just how dumb Aja gets in this episode. How does she get duped into
Well,
chasing
you know,
after?
what would you do if you saw one of the kids that you're supposed to take care of in a place where they're not supposed to be? Your instinct would be to go see what they're doing there and run after them. That's exactly what she does.
Okay, I'll grant you that. I guess my only thing is, you know, how would she? I guess, you know, the way I see Aja is that she's got a lot more smarts. I mean, she's a really, really smart woman.
Yeah, Aja is very smart.
And I guess following Ashley through the bus and then, you know, especially around in the cargo bay where she gets locked in it, you know, it just floors me that, you know, it's one of those like old school comedies, like, you know, that you would see like with the Three Stooges or
Yeah.
with Laurel and Hardy or something like that. You don't expect somebody as brainy as Aja to be completely like, you know, what is that old boxing term? The rope-a-dope type of thing. You know, you fake him with one, but then you slam him with another type of thing.
Yeah,
You
take
know.
down.
Yeah, it really was a fake out. It's just such an interesting thing that she fell for. But then
But it
again,
all happened so quick. Maybe it's a momentary lapse in judgment, but it does not mean that Aja is stupid by any means. She's
oh no,
still
no, no.
smart.
No, exactly. So we find that she gets locked in the baggage compartment, and obviously now that we go into second act in the show, and before we go on, I want to let everybody know that you can call into our show and voice your opinion about this, and give us your insight as to what you may see in the show. And our number is 1-724-444-7444. Our show call ID number is 93860, and then press pound after that. So we get into the second act, and there's a lot of thumping going on from Aja pounding on the luggage compartment door that she's trapped inside of this big, almost like a Greyhound bus type of thing. And she's pounding and pounding, and there's a passenger in it who, by the way, is voiced by Cindy McGee. I
I noticed
did
that
listen
too. That's
very, very carefully.
Shayna.
Yeah, it's our Shayna, exactly. And she goes up to the bus driver, who, by the way, I thought was very rude to her. What do you want? What's his attitude? It's like, get your butt on the yellow line. It's like, and like, all I want to say is there's like this loud thump. I got a flat tire or whatever. And he's like, oh, I don't hear nothing. But he does actually pull over, goes and checks, and is like, oh, the tires are okay here. And he hears that pounding again, and all of a sudden he opens up the door, and Aja just leaps out of nowhere, starts running, and he just freaks out at her, like, hey! It's like, what are you going to do? You going to get her for hitching a ride in your luggage
Yeah.
compartment? I mean, it's not like she was a stowaway. But,
He didn't know what was going on. He was clueless.
no, and I love when she tries to get back to to the event, because she runs into these two guys who are completely. I swear, I've never seen more stupid people before in my life. They're like, yeah, I need to get back to this. How do you get back to this venue or whatever? And like, oh, you go up here and you go to the left or whatever. No, you go to the right. I'll be outraged. It's just these
Or
guys just
block
have this
right,
huge battle.
block left. Yeah, back and forth, back and forth. They are
Yeah, I
arguing,
absolutely,
getting in each other's
they really
face
did.
about it.
Yeah, they really did. And the funny thing is, and you have this, I never figured this one out, but you literally had a cowboy guy coming in on a chopper, basically. Now, obviously, this is probably symbolic of the cowboy rescuing, from the early days when horses were this very noble,
Oh,
riding off into the sunset type of thing.
I look at that and I think, well, I guess you'll see anything in Vegas. Anything's normal there.
Well, that's true. You could also say that about Mardi Gras, which we'll end up talking about later on in the future. So she finally hitches a ride with him. It's funny how she actually gets on the bike. I mean, she doesn't do it very ladylike. Like her whole body, like just completely, her body contorts,
And of course,
and
she's wearing a short skirt and she just
yeah, really.
climbs up there. Yeah.
I always thought that was funny. And then of course you see him drive off, and then they get stuck in a traffic jam, and she's like, okay, now I gotta hoof it. And she's wearing heels too. She's wearing, high heels,
As
and so she has
usual,
to run
yeah,
in them.
they're always in heels. Running in heels is not easy. I would not suggest that anybody try that at home.
Yeah, KJEM Radio does not condone the running in high heel shoes.
That's right.
We really don't. So anyway, we flip channels a little, or flip scenes a little quick here, and we find that Rio is panicking, looking all over the place for Aja, and he ends up running into the Misfits dressing room, and they're like, "Well, you ain't going in there." And Pizzazz, shuts up Roxy again. Again, Roxy gets pushed out of the way. And she's like, okay, go ahead, go on. And this is the first time you get a glimpse at Pizzazz hitting on Rio, which does happen kind of throughout the series. Like she's, why are you with Jem? You can have me. And I think, what was Rio's line? He says, you're not even fit to be in the same room with Jem or
You're
something like
not even
that.
fit to breathe the same air as them, something like that,
Yeah.
yeah.
I like how he told her off like that. That was absolutely brilliant. And then I love her little, I always love how Patricia, who voiced Pizzazz,
Yeah.
just let out that nice scream at the end. She's like,
I know.
nobody ever does that. I love it. So of
Nobody
course,
does the screams like her. I love her screams.
she is just an amazing screamer, and well, they all are. Jeez, how many times did those Misfits scream when they got into a trouble or whatever? So of course, he doesn't see her in there, and they're going back out like, we don't know where any we don't even know any idea where she is, and then the promoter's like, okay, forget this, Misfits take the stage, you're up, and they're happy, they're cheering, they're all excited, and all of a sudden, here comes Aja running up, saying, "I'm here, we can go on." And I thought, it's just hilarious that the Misfits literally throw a fit, and they're like, "You guys still get to open the show. You guys are still going to go on stage anyway. You're just not going to be the headliners." And I thought that was just really funny.
But that's not good enough. And what I love is they're like, you know, "You can still warm up the show." And Pizzazz is like, "Oh, I wouldn't warm up leftovers for those no talents." And then Roxy right behind her, "And you, don't come talking to us about penalty clauses, Joker. Like, don't you dare try to get us for not performing."
Yeah, really. You ain't going to get them on breach of contract, I'll tell you that. And Roxy would make doggone sure. Again, there's that Roxy attitude, and she doesn't put that on for Pizzazz, but she'll sure as heck stand up to an outsider, you know. We're going to go back to the lines here and talk again to Princess Hikaru.
I wonder if it seems like Roxy is like that, you know, that tough girl with guys. Like, you know, maybe I've seen it in the show more with girls, but... like, she's pretty brutal to the opposite sex.
I think it would be just how she was treated. I mean, you know, she rolled with, you know, the Red Aces back in the day, and, you know, I don't know how they treated her, but it seemed like she was kind of like the boss of that gang, you know, and, like, nobody messed with her, you know. So she probably had a really bad experience, you know. And when we start talking about the character developments, Roxy's going to be one of them, and I have a lot to say about that. I, you know, one of the things I always felt is that she was abused. I mean, she probably had the crap kicked out of her as a kid, so, I mean, you know, that probably is one reason why she's so, you know, angry towards men, you know, and not so much towards women. But, you know, again,
well,
that's just...
she can be tough to anybody. She just tends to jump in quicker if it's some man that's from the outside, you know, quicker than she would. Although, she's really quick to jump on Jetta, too, which is hilarious, you know, later in the episode.
Yeah, I love that. I'm going to clean your clock.
Yeah, go ahead and try. I love that.
Yeah, exactly. So of course we get through with you know, the Misfits throwing their fit or whatever, and of course we come into the video called "Too Close for Comfort," which is you know, an interesting little song. It's not one of my personal favorite songs. It's just, you know,
no,
it's just kind of one of those
favorite videos either. Although I don't know what else they really could have done with it. I mean, you know, I like the images and stuff. It's just, yeah, not one of my favorites, but it's okay.
Yeah, and one of the things I like about this whole segment coming up now is how behind the scenes that everything is going on, you have Eric planning this whole thing to get back at JEM, and what he's going to do is he's going to create a quote-unquote commotion. And, of course, what he's basically going to do is he's going to set up JEM and the Holograms, or specifically JEM, to take the fall for a theft. So that way she gets arrested and the Misfits can take the stage and get all the money and whatever, and be the victors in this whole thing. And, you know, one of the things that kind of floors me about this too is that this is when you start noticing Stormer as a very fearful girl of Pizzazz. You know, Pizzazz is one of these types of people who just has a very short fuse, and if you say the wrong thing to her, if you look at her wrong, she will burn a hole through your body with her eyes or scream at you or whatever. And you can see that she's literally put the, you know, the fear of God in Stormer.
She says that she tells Ashley that she was, you know, kind of afraid of Pizzazz and Roxy, and, you know, rightfully so. But, oh, when she says that, though, this is just a side note, but you know how they're behind the big cardboard cutout of JEM and the Holograms?
Yes.
That life-size thing, I want one of those. That was so awesome.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool.
I have a life-size one of Reba, so I was like, I was watching that going, I want a JEM one. Yeah, right. But it was cool.
Yeah, it really was. All those really cool posters. That, you know, that'd be really great if that would have been released as some of the items you could have bought, like, you know,
so
a big cutout of JEM. Yeah. See, and then Hasbro would not have had to put all their eggs in one basket and put everything on the dolls as opposed to putting them into the show. You know, put them into the items that are in the show, you know, the posters, all that stuff, man. That could have been a marketing brilliance, you know. Barbie never had that. They could have easily cashed in on that, but, you know, that's just businesses that, you know, executives that don't always think, but, you know. So, of course, this commotion is overheard by Ashley, and and Stormer behind this cardboard cutout, as Amy alluded to. They are both freaked out about this whole thing. They don't want anybody, you know, getting hurt, because right now Zipper and his goons are essentially going to plant the evidence, and they're right there witnessing it, or I should say hearing it. They're not seeing it, but they're hearing it. And of course, they run off, and then eventually end up calling the police, and because the money is stolen, there's like thousands of dollars being stolen. It's like the entire show, you know, from the ticket booth was completely taken or whatever. And they're like, you know, where'd this money go? And the funny thing is, you notice how it was a dead giveaway from Pizzazz when she said, oh, check her bag.
I know.
You know, check
right
Jem's.
Away, it's like, point her out across the room. It's like, oh, check her room. You know, it's like, wow, that's obvious. Like, no, you didn't have anything to do with that.
Yeah, and that's the one of the things that I always found was really interesting is that, you know, Pizzazz, for how much she really wants to sabotage, she opens up her mouth far too much to blame them and, you know, makes her look guilty. And, you know, so that, of course,
well,
you
I
know,
think they do search Pizzazz's room, too, and she's like, fine, sure, whatever, go ahead, because she knows that they won't find anything in her room. But, yeah, she's awfully quick to point the finger at Jem.
Yeah. And I think you make a valid point that they did check their room. I did forget about that. One of the things, too, is that they did find the money. And you notice the bag they found in was a big gem bag, which I thought was,
yeah.
Where was that item in the toy stores? Why didn't that get sold? What a cool concept. A nice gig bag, you know? most, I think everybody would have, too. And then, of course, we come up to the final part of the act, which is you see a close-up of Jem's hands behind her back, handcuffed.
Yeah, something we thought we'd never see. Like, what's going on? Jem's getting arrested. She didn't even do anything.
So, finally, folks, we got to the final act.
Yeah,
of course,
right.
We start off with Ashley.
It looks bad for Jem because, you know, we left off with her in handcuffs, right? And we're, like, going, oh, no, what next? And Ashley steps up. And she runs up and says, you know, she didn't do it. And, like, they're going to believe a little kid because, of course, the Misfits are like, she lives with them. She'll say anything. And, she tells them what she heard. And, you know, like they said, they kind of need more proof than just this kid that lives with them in the hologram. So up walks a mystery lady out of nowhere. How convenient. And she backs her up. And I gotta say, even when I was little and watching this, the second that lady walked up, I knew who that was. You know, like obvious. Like,
yeah,
hey,
I think most people figure that out.
And but yet the holograms and Misfits didn't seem to know who it was.
Yeah, not even by the crackly voice either, which I think is hilarious because, I mean, you know, there was almost no removal of Stormer's voice, so that might mean that Stormer really didn't know how to act. So, well,
I know,
I forgot.
We
yeah.
know that Sue Blue can do all these kinds of voices, and we know that she could have changed up the voice if she wanted to, but she kind of left it as Stormer's normal voice. So.
Well, I think
maybe
part of that might have been for the
act.
Audience, too.
Well, yeah. Maybe they wanted to give it away who it was.
Let's go back to the phone line real quick and get Princess Hikaru's, Hikaru, yeah.
Hikaru.
So I'm still getting your name right. I apologize. What is your take on this third act?
Well, I knew it was Stormer. I mean, you know, the voice gave it away. I'm sorry, Mystery Lady, that whole scene just cracks me up. So... I mean, I know why she dressed up like that, because she can't betray Pizzazz openly.
Right.
But, yeah, it was pretty obvious.
I agree with that.
Now, okay, thanks to Stormer, as we've all discussed, Jem is set free. Hallelujah. Okay, so then Eric, in this next scene, has this brilliant idea. I mean, after they've performed and everything, we go on to the scene with Eric talking to the Misfits and... His idea is, maybe Jem is just a stage name. Maybe that's not her real name, you think? You know, but...
Like
and
yours,
like,
Phyllis.
Yeah, Phyllis. And
oh,
like,
what a slap in the face, man.
Don't
like you
never call me that.
I love that. That is hilarious. Yeah, I mean, well, think about that. I mean, that's an old school name, you know?
That's the first time we hear it in the show. The first time we figure out that, you know, we knew it was a stage name, but that's... Her real name is Phyllis.
Yep. And, you know, we kind of figure out that Roxy's Roxanne and things like that. And we don't really find out Storm's real name either until much later in the series, which I thought was kind of a shame.
Yeah, and you never would guess, really, Stormer's name just, you know, by, you know, because it's not close, anything close to Stormer, like, you know, Roxy, Roxanne, you know. But anyway, Eric, his idea now is to hire a private detective, Malone, some creepy guy, to follow Jim around and try to figure out who she really is. Now, I got to admit, that was kind of a good idea. I mean, it's like, well, it's about time, you know, do something smart. But so their next, Holograms' next appearance is at a fashion show for Danielle Dubuisson and her clothing line. So they're modeling her fashions up there on the stage, and they sing the song Truly Outrageous. I love that song, and I honestly, you know, with that being a catchphrase that Kimber says all the time, you know, Jim, it's truly outrageous, and it was on all the merchandise. Yep. I really thought that that song would be used more in the show. But that's the
it
one
was.
And
actually,
only
it
time
was
that we hear it.
Right, but in the show, yes, but it was more designed for the doll line and all the toys that went along with Jim. And if you listen, if you go up on YouTube, you can find most of these clips still available. And you'll hear, you know, she's truly, truly outrageous, you know, and sometimes you hear the Misfits theme, you know, the one, you know, we are the Misfits, where our songs are better. Mm-hmm. And, but the one that was specifically designed, and this is the one where everybody's, you know, Anne is even upset about this, that they used it, was the, you know, the Gem Girl song, which was meant for the toy line, as was Truly Outrageous. The We Are the Misfits is supposed to be for the series as the opening theme all the way through, including the closing credits, not the other ones. So, again,
and I've noticed on the DVDs, even early episodes that are definitely not supposed to have the Gem Girl theme have it. Like, I remember when I was a kid, the Gem Girl theme came in, I think, around season two, or, you know, I know it wasn't really separated into major seasons, but you know what I mean. It later, after, like, Rhea and Jetta are introduced, then I think is when it started being played, or maybe even in the reruns. But originally, the first episodes all had the Truly Outrageous Jim song, you know, the theme song. So
The theme song for the commercials, are you talking?
I'm talking about the coming on of the TV show, you know, the
when they sing,
the Misfits sing, and they're supposed to, you know, the Misfits are supposed to be included. That song was supposed to be used for the theme, and then in these DVDs, I've noticed a lot of the early episodes have the Gem Girl theme, which is not right.
Yeah, and that was, I think that was part of another reason why Rhino got into a lot of trouble, was because they were using things that weren't supposed to be used in the opening credits. I think if you have the original VHSs of some of the episodes, do you not?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Okay, so you would, so you can go all the way back. You can go all the way back to those videos, and
that's why.
And,
yeah, that's why I'm saying that when they were originally run and originally put out, all these earlier episodes, especially, use the original theme song, like they're supposed.
Yeah, the We Are the Misfits.
Yeah.
And that's and I hope when if Shout Factory, which we try to promote that all the time. If you want the DVDs made, go to Shout Factory's website. We have a link to it on our KJEM Radio fan site. Go there and post that you want the video or the DVDs remade, because that's one of the things that needs to be corrected. Is go back to the original masters and pull the way it's supposed to be. Don't cut anything. Don't delete scenes. Don't do nothing. Just bring out the original music that was there for the theme song, for the opening and closing, and, you know, leave it alone. It was great while it was there. Don't change anything. Just my
opinion.
That's right.
They just change too many things, and even little changes can get on the fans' nerves. I mean, you know, bothers me. Pizzazz's hair color and the changing of the theme, that's just little things that bug me. But I'm still happy for the DVDs. I mean, I got to say, at least they got released, but I wish that the rest of the episodes would come out, too. Now, back to
That's
the
very
show.
True. Back yes, back to the show.
Back to where we were. It's, the
After our little commercial interruption there.
Yeah, our ads were Bring Out Jim DVDs. The Misfits are there, you know, to cause trouble, of course, and they just can't stand it that the Holograms are getting so much attention at the fashion show, so you know, they get the bright idea to set off the sprinklers and ruin the whole thing, which they did it at the end of the show, so I'm not sure what that really accomplished. You know, they waited until it was just about over, and then they set off the sprinklers, but
I don't know if this is an animator thing or what, but it's the only time you ever see it, but it's Roxy's little heart tattoo on her arm, and you look really carefully. She actually has a heart tattoo, which I thought was hysterical because you never see that again.
Yeah, you never see that. So therefore, it is a fake stick-on because it never comes back. It was either an inside joke by an animator or just for that outfit or something. So
yeah, really, that was hysterical. You know, like you said, the whole thing about them went to last minute, you know, and I didn't even realize that actually is true. They actually waited until, like, the very end. So it's either they got there late or just honestly could not think of a plan to actually, you know, get their attention until they went up to the balcony area of the room. And I think that's just hilarious. Like, oh, hey, we're just going to make every, you know, the show's already over, so we're just going to force everybody out.
We're just going to make everybody mad by getting them all wet. Yeah, okay.
That one part where all the girls are in the car and they're still sopping wet.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, wouldn't you think you would dry off, blow dry your hair, make yourself look fabulous, and then go out into the world?
Well, yeah, if I was a rock star, I would at least, you know, dry off or change clothes, I would think.
Exactly. Now, this final scene that you're going to talk about here, Amy, is probably one of my favorites. Just because it's like, you know what, it's one of those things that, you know, how close, you know, people came to learning about Synergy.
I know.
This is the closest we're ever going to get that the real people are going to know about her.
That's
so
right. The Malone guy is still following Jem and the Holograms, and he follows them back to the Starlight Drive-In, which is still where they are keeping Synergy at this point. And he, you know, they go in, that's when they change and then go back out, the Holograms. And when they leave, this Malone guy breaks in, you know, all he's got to do is walk through the wall anyway, and discovers Synergy. And, you know, that's a big problem. I mean, if only they had used this. I always thought, you know, there's an episode, I think it's The Presidential Dilemma or something, where they kind of allude back to this, and they have pictures of Synergy that this guy took, but because he did take a snapshot or two and show Eric, but they allude back to it, but I always wish that there was another episode to where Eric actually did something about it, you know? But
yeah,
that's
really true. Yeah, and that's one of those things where, you know, you kind of wonder if it just got lost as the series went on. Like, nobody ever thought, you know, what would have Eric really done?
Yeah, they at least mentioned it again, but then it reminds you. It's like, oh, yeah, he's got this evidence. He's so close to finding out, and yet he does nothing with it. But
yeah,
anyway, when Malone breaks in, I always thought it was funny. Synergy's just like, intruder, 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 over and over. It's like, shut up. No wonder she
Poor Marlene. Poor Marlene. She just had to keep repeating that.
He just grabs stuff and starts to smash her because, oh, heaven forbid he figure out how to turn the thing off or unplug it. No, just smash it. This big, humongous computer that's worth probably $1 million.
Yeah, no doubt. And I thought that was hilarious. I mean, so either he must have had one of those, you know, tempers where he's like, you know, and he can't deal with annoying noises or something like that, you know, and didn't want cops to hear. But it seemed like Starlight Theater was far out in the boonies, so, you know, you probably don't know how many people would actually hear it or not. But, you know, I do think that's just hysterical that he just decides to smash the thing. You know, forget everything else. I'm just going to smash your computer. I don't care.
Yeah. Like, oh, an interesting thing. We can use this for evidence. Let me take a picture and then destroy it. Ugh, idiot.
Exactly. And, of course, that is actually where the show wrapped up until, you know, it was another to be continued in the final installment of, which is Battle of the Bands. And
we'll
be talking
week.
About
we'll be talking
that one
about
next
that.
Week. Yeah, that'll be really, really fun. And, of course, you know, on my remarks to this, I think it's, you know, really starting to define the characters. You know, we're definitely done with the exposition, thank goodness, because I can't stand exposition. And I think that, you know, the one thing, too, is that, you know, Kimber, going from Kimber's Rebellion to the frame-up, we finally see that she actually chilled. You know, maybe they gave her some Prozac or something back then. I don't know what they did, but they calmed her down. But I just think that's, you know, hilarious that, you know, they finally started to get that, you know, nailing down that the cast members and things like that. Because obviously we do end up losing one of the characters later in the series, partly because Christy did not like the character, and we ended up getting a new one in his replace. Yeah. And of course, we will talk about that character disappearing forever, kind of like how Richie Cunningham's little older brother runs upstairs with the basketball and never comes down again. We never see him again after the pilot episode of Happy Days. So anyway, we wanted to thank our caller tonight and for adding her thoughts to the show. It was really, really insightful. And of course, we want to say join us next week for the conclusion of the miniseries called Battle of the Bands, which will pretty much tie up all the loose ends in the first four episodes. We ran over time tonight, but that's okay. It's always fun doing this, you know. No time is, you know, more time spent on GEM is more people getting involved with it. So, again, thank you guys, and have a great night, and we will see you next week. Take care, and bye.
Thanks for tuning in, everybody. We appreciate it.